Good afternoon, everybody. Apologies for the delay in the start of the meeting. We were tied up at the closed session agenda. It's now 6:47 p.m. We're beginning the City Council, Calexico Community Redevelopment Agency, Successor Agency, Calexico Financing Authority, regular meeting today, August 21st, 2012, at the Fernando Nene Torres Council Chambers. City Attorney, I'll defer to you for the closest agenda items.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd first like to note that the closed session agenda, it's listed with four items, but there's only three letters there. But so I just want to clarify, there were four items discussed. On all those items, direction was given, no reportable action was taken. Thank you.
Thank you. City Clerk, Luli, note that all five council members are present. If we can go to the Pledge of Allegiance, Councilman Hodge.
Sure, please stand. Ready to begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
Council, is there a motion to approve the agenda plus the addendum?
So, second.
Excuse me, before we go, if I may retrieve that, we're going to need to pull one of the items on the...
I believe there's going to be a few items pulled off the agenda.
Okay,
but we can do that when we get there.
All right. We've already approved the agenda and the addendum. We'll go to the presentation. Okay, is anybody from the parish hall here? No. Okay, can you just turn around, please? In case some of you don't know, Father Gerardo has been transferred to a parish in San Diego. So this council is extending this proclamation. Father Gerardo Fernandez from Our Lady of Guadalupe, Calexico, California. Whereas the City of Calexico believes it is important that we honor and acknowledge to those members of our community who compassionately contribute to the betterment and the continuance of peace in our community. Whereas Father Gerardo has been an inspiration and strong supporter of the youth in our community, and whereas Father Gerardo served Our Lady of Guadalupe Parish for 1 year in 2002 and for 6 years from 2006 to 2012. Whereas Father Gerardo was instrumental in the repayment of the loan for the construction of the Juan Diego Parish Hall. And whereas Father Gerardo served his parish with kindness, honor, and respect. And now, therefore, be it resolved that the City Council of the City of Calexico hereby expresses its profound gratitude and respect to Pastor Gerardo Fernandez for his contributions to our community. In witness thereof, I hereunto affix my signature and official seal of the City of Calexico on its 21st day of August 2012. Thank you, Father Gerardo, and good luck in your new assignment, I guess. Pass it over to you. Okay, after that presentation, we'll go to public comments.
May I just ask a question? We do have an addendum to the agenda as well.
We approved the agenda and the addendum a moment ago. Announcements and public comments. Public comments are welcome. Speakers will be limited to 3 minutes, which I will ask City Council Member Moreno to monitor and remind the speaker at 2 minutes, 30 seconds. Please complete a speaker form prior to the start of the meeting. If the item you wish to comment on is in a closed session item, Please comment now before we open the closed agenda, the consent calendar. If the item you wish to comment on is on the public portion of the agenda, we will take your comment when we get to the item on the agenda. I have several requests. I'll start with Carmen Estrada, sponsor recognition.
Buenas tardes, soy Carmen Estrada, fundadora del programa CIPAR. Va a tener las palabras ahorita Tony García y luego yo. Gracias.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Mayor, honorable term, City Council. I did fill out one of those, but we'll take care of this now.
Okay, thank you.
Folks, I'm briefly going to state what's occurring recently with CPAL. We sent a couple of teams to the California State Games in July in San Diego this past 2-3 weeks ago. And we had really good luck. We had really good teams. And I it's a great honor for me to present to you the 8-year-old Calexico United State Champs. Along the same line, it also gives me great honor to introduce 15-year-old Calexico Eagles, state champs 3 years in a row. I'm pretty sure they get their chance for a picture. After winning their division at the state games, they got invited to participate in national games in Pennsylvania next July. We are going to go. We are going to do as much fundraising as possible. We're going to wash cars, do whatever we have to send these gentlemen, these kids, these children, these participants, these Calexico natives to Pennsylvania to represent Calexico. That'll be next July. I cannot continue without thanking the coaches for each individual team. For the 7 and 8 year olds, I got Pedro Nunez, Samuel Ortiz, and Julio Flores. For the Calexico Eagles, 15-year-old, I've got Felipe Mesa and Federico Miranda. On a quick note on the 15-year-olds, in the semifinals, the 15-year-olds defeated a team from Nigeria. We already have international flavor in there. And for the championship, they defeated the San Diego Aztecs. So I'm very proud of these gentlemen, everybody here, especially their parents, because this continues to be a parent organization. They put in so many hours and so much sacrifice. The sponsors, Mr. Hermosillo, thank you very much for everything. Chief, thank you very much for everything. If I miss anybody, I apologize, but this is an emotional state. I have before me state champions. Congratulations.
Gracias a toda la comunidad de Calexico por haber apoyado a este programa que es tan importante para la comunidad, para seguir, disculpe, estoy muy emocionada porque llevamos 150 niños a San Diego, luchamos mucho para llegar a en donde estamos, los jóvenes de 18 y 20 años también participaron, sacaron cuarto lugar. Y tenemos otro equipo que sacó tercer lugar, pero ahorita está participando en los juegos, en el torneo de los barrios, por eso no está aquí presente. Fuimos en total 400 personas ahí a San Diego, y yo como organizadora estoy muy contenta porque fue todo un éxito decir Calexico México, y con el apoyo de ustedes, porque no alcanzábamos la meta, nos dieron $2,500 para pagar transportación y gasolina de los jóvenes grandes, porque ellos no pudieron alcanzar a sacar el dinero para llevar a cabo el viaje. Y yo estoy agradecida que en una semana se llevó a cabo y nos pagaron eso, el concilio. Gracias, Oscar, porque eran las 7 de la tarde, un jueves, que ya estaba desesperada porque no salía el cheque y salió ahí. Gracias, Castro. Gracias a todos, a la Asociación de Policía, a Willy Hermosillo. Si me falta alguien, por favor, disculpen, el IID. Y, discúlpame, somos grandes y brillamos y vamos a seguir adelante. Con la fuerza de nosotros vamos a lograr a llegar a ser algo más grande aquí en Calexico. Somos a nivel condado. Y gracias a todos ustedes. Y al que no nos apoya, también gracias. Pero somos grandes.
También tengo uno de Felipe Mesa.
Buenas tardes a todos. Mi nombre es Felipe Mesa y el motivo de estar aquí es agradecer en primer a los papás de mis jugadores, porque sin ellos no estuviéramos donde estamos. Tenemos 3 años seguidos ganando primer lugar en ese torneo y quisiera el año que viene, si vuelvo a venir aquí, a agradecerse a que fuera más gente, no solamente a los papás, porque son los que nos movemos. Quiero agradecer al programa El PAB, que dirige la señora Estrada y que es lo que mantiene a los jóvenes ocupados haciendo deporte y no haciendo otras cosas o pensando, todos sabemos qué. Quiero agradecer al señor Hermosillo y un miembro del concilio que creyó en nuestra idea, que creyó en nuestro sueño, que es el señor Castro. Por último, le quiero pedir, no sé de quién depende la ciudad, que por favor vean, volteen a su alrededor los parques, necesitamos que los muchachos, todos los niños, jóvenes, niños, estén ocupados haciendo deporte. Lo ocupamos. Si se dieran una vuelta por el área de San Diego, el área de Yuma, que es el mismo clima, no puede ser que ellos tengan unos parques diferentes a los de nosotros. No lo entiendo, pero bueno, eso es lo que quería decirlo. Y desde hace mucho tiempo y ahorita se me presentó la oportunidad. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, señor Mesa. Stella Mendoza, ID Director. Ms. Mendoza, first and foremost, thank you for being here. Unfortunately, it's the first representative from the ID that we had for some time. Thank you.
Well, thank you. First of all, I want to commend you on your beautiful city council chambers. You probably have the most beautiful chambers in the whole valley. You're very smart to get it before the redevelopment funds ran out, so it's a beautiful building. I'm here to let you know about the new residential weatherization program that we have just getting started at the IID. What's really unique about this program that it's offered to all our IID customers. It's not just for the low income or special income folks, but for everybody. The cost is $100. And you have to have an IID residential account. It could be for your home, it could be for a mobile home. And what they will do up to $1,000 of energy efficient work on your house. It includes the electric water heater, wrap, the duct ceiling, the shade screens, the weather stripping, attic fans, other things. And it's really, really neat. We have a contract with the company, and we have allocated $1.5 million for this service, and they tell me that the money will run out by the end of the year. I think it's going to run out in 60 days because this is a really popular program. So I'm going to leave some leaflets here with you, and I encourage you to call the toll-free number or go online and look into this program because it's a good way to save on your cooling and on your heating energy bills. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Mendoza. Newgate, north side of Cesar Chavez School, Luis Soberanes.
Hi, how you doing? My name is Luis Soberanes. How you doing? Thank you for giving me an opportunity to talk. Two things. First, to give praise. I was part of the family. I'm the parent of one of the children that went to the game, and I had a good time with them. Thanks to the coach, or the rest of the people, and thanks to the team. Way to go. Way to go. The reason I came before you is in Cesar Chavez, there's a lot of traffic to drop off kids and to pick kids up. We already had a couple of incidents where they run over kids. And I spoke with a couple of people and told them that it would have been a good idea to put a different gate on the north side of the school, right adjacent to the water retention basin. The land belongs to the city, and if we could build a ramp of dirt, like for people that jog around like you have on the other parks or a couple other parks, and put a gate there, and then we can drop off kids on Meadow Drive, and there's a whole sidewalk. There's nobody there. There's no houses there. You can drop off kids there. They can just walk to the gate and come back at the end of the day. That will alleviate more than half of the traffic that's on Zapata. On Zapata in the morning, you can't get out of there or you can't get in there. It's just a big old mess. The police people, the police department, they try to do their best, but you know, there's only two lanes. There's so much you can do. And they added extra cross guards, and it helps, but it doesn't alleviate the problem. If you guys, you know, would, you know, drive by there in the morning, 8 o'clock, just drive by there. Take Zapata and drive by there, and then drive by there when they pick up the kids and see if you can get out of there. And you can see kids being frustrated trying to cross the street. And they're not supposed to, but there's so much cars that, you know, it's an idea. You know, think about it. I think it's a good idea, and it's a very minimal investment. You know, I'm pretty sure we can come up with it. It's just a gate and to fix the dirt. It's just an idea.
Mr. Nick Servin, who's a public works director, he can probably help you with that concern. Mm-hmm. And Nick, if you can give us a report at the next council meeting how this thing was addressed.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I apologize if I mispronounced your name, Charla Teeters, Imperial County Film Commission.
Good evening. Thanks for letting me come up here and just speak this evening. My name is Charlotte Teeters, and I am with the Imperial County Film Commission. I'm the film commissioner for the county, and I just wanted to come and give you an update on filming in the valley and just say thank you to the city of Calexico. As most of you probably know, we did have a feature film that was filming here in Calexico 2 weeks ago. And I wanted to say thank you so much to your public works department, to your police department, and basically just to the city of Calexico for receiving this production so well, making them feel so welcome. They had nothing but good things to say. And they were just thrilled with their time here in Calexico. So I just wanted to say thank you for that.
Thank you, Ms. Peters.
And the Film Commission, just so you know, in the past fiscal year, we've had 44 track projects in the valley. That's from June 30th of 2011 to July 1st of 2012. And so far this year, we have had three additional items shot in the month of August. So it's been a really busy year, and I'm glad to see that I'm able to funnel more production down into Calexico and that they're using this great city as a backdrop. So thank you for having me.
Thank you. Thank you for doing what you did. Something about an empty lot by Jose Aldazoro.
Good Good evening. My name is Jose Aldazoro. I live on Pauline, at 1000 Pauline Avenue, apartment A. We have an empty lot on 10th and Imperial, where USA gas station used to be. It's very dirty, filthy, I mean, you name it. Compared to the other lot on Grand and Imperial, it's empty also, but it's very clean. Why is dirty? Why the other one is so dirty? It gets all the dust, all the papers to us, right there to the duplex. They don't clean it, they don't do anything. I mean, why one is empty, so nice, and the other one is so dirty? I don't know why. People, they come in from out of town, they come in, and it's just across the street from AutoZone. I mean, dirty. Escalexico. I mean, why one is empty is clean and the other one is dirty? That's why I was wondering why.
City Manager Rodriguez, you have any information that you can provide?
No, I don't know if our Public Works Director does, but if nothing else, we can certainly check it out and take care of it.
Okay. If Mr. Servin, can you give him your card? So.
No, that's it.
Yes, he will help you address the issue.
All righty. Okay, thank you. That's
thank,
it.
Thank you very much. Okay. I don't know if you want to stay for the remainder of the sessions. Carmen Estrada, Tony Garcia.
We're just waiting for you to say something.
Yeah, now, you want to take this moment to leave or you want to stay on here? Say, you're going to stay? You're going to leave? Well, I mean, obviously, congratulations to all of you for accomplishing what you have. I know that keeping the kids together till your next event, which is in July of 2013, you said? Tony, for July 2013? Okay, pues obviously keep everybody informed to see how the city can support it. Thank you. Yeah, I know. Okay, we'll resume the meeting. I'll call on the following persons that have requested discussion on items under the consent calendar.
which will be discussed at this point. Mr. Casillas, you have two items, number 6 and number 11. If you want to come forward at this time.
I believe I also have number 11 here.
I'm sorry, yes, you have 11 here, number 6.
6, 10, and 11.
Okay, now is the time, please.
Which one would you like me to speak about first?
Go in numerical sequence.
Number 6. Well, number 6 is a very alarming item. And the reason for that is it was brought to the attention of the city about 3 months ago that the guns that we are currently carrying, every officer, including the chief and the lieutenant as they sit in the audience today, may not work. A gun, even if it's brand new out of the box, has the potential of misfiring. After a gun has been used for 14 years, that potential doubles. It's fallen on deaf ears. Please, Mayor, I don't want a business card. This is the safety of the officers that we represent and the safety of your community. Why it's been taking so long, I don't know. We got Measure H money, we got asset forfeiture money. There's no excuses. It's a lack of transparency, lack of leadership. It's a breakdown of city government at its best. And there's no excuse for us not to carry weapons that function. And something needs to be done about it. I know that you got it on there now and needs to be expedited and needs to be taken care of immediately. And as an association, it needs to be a priority. So can you please cut some of this red tape and not look at the chief or the lieutenant, because it's not their fault. They passed this forward. They pushed this up just as we did, just as we try to take care of it. And nothing gets taken care of around here. And it's very frustrating. So if we can please take care of that, Mayor.
Okay, number 10.
Number 10 and 11. Although it seems like a great gesture, it's truly a mockery. It's truly a mockery. Because I don't know about you guys, but I don't know if the council drives around with the blindfold around the city, but I don't. I don't know all you have to do is look out the window, sir. These restrooms, I don't know about you, but I walked into those restrooms about an hour ago. There's feces on the floor. There's urine on the floor. There's transients. They're dirty. Before you put a water fountain and benches for kids to go, it has to be a clean, safe environment. I don't want to take my kids there. Why would I? It's a mockery. It's a mockery. It's a desperate attempt to retain your seat, sir. And you cannot give me a business card. At one point or another, you have to take responsibility for the city. You are the mayor. Don't shoot out to Servin or to Nick. By the way, I like the sun in his front yard. It's very nice, very attractive. Take some responsibility. Let's start there. Before we put water fountains and benches, let's make it a clean, safe environment for our kids to go to these parks, because it's a mockery. It's a mockery. You know, look, these folks, it's a mockery what's going on here. Please, save yourself the trouble. You look bad when you do this. You know, you're a day late, a buck short, sir. A day late, a buck short. 3 months before it's election time, you want to put in water fountains and benches? Let's clean up the park first. Thank you.
You have one more item.
And by the way, Risen Field was not put on the list. I truly believe, you know where Risen Field is, the field that the parents and the community and the Police Officers Association helped put a baseball diamond on there. We've been promoting this field. And it's sad because that field is used every day. That field was not put on that list. I looked at the backup. It wasn't put on the list. And I don't know. Maybe I'm just thinking of stuff, or maybe it's a conspiracy, but is it because that field is supported by the Police Officers Association? I hope not, because the only people that are being hurt here are the kids from the community. Thank you.
We have one more. No, let them off. Okay. Not worth a response. Mr. Risen, you have something in the fountains and tables as well.
Well, the same as, I'm going to take it back, but Casilla says, I mean, I'm the one that brought it to him, that Risen Field has no consideration. You know, we spend over $40,000 of private funds and the POA helping us, and yet you guys don't even consider one water fountain or benches. Now, WIPE is a water retention basin. Well, so is Gutierrez Park. Why is he on the list and Rising Park is not? And then why did it take so long? In 2009, didn't they give you the okay on this grant? Why are you using it now? Is it a campaign pledge? I don't know what it is, but I feel that we expedite this and put Rising Field on that list. Thank you.
Mr. Gonzalez, you have under consent calendar items 10, 11, 12, 17, 19, and 20.
I think the legitimacy of the speakers that went before me is indicative of what I'm going to talk about. I think that, Mr. Mayor, you're responsible. You like to pretend that things don't happen, that Calexico is rosy, that we have no problems. I have the same concern. This grant was 2009. I realize that Oscar wasn't here, the business manager or budget director wasn't here, but you were here, and so was the council. And only because of election, we're doing that. That's like putting a Band-Aid on something that has cancer. We have major problems, Mayor. We don't have a library open on Friday. We don't have City Hall all open on Fridays. You know, it's a shame. I was born and raised here, and the kids can't use the computers on Fridays and Saturdays. When you do that, you prohibit their growth to be able to communicate in a global economy. And Mayor, that's what you ought to be focusing on. I know Mr. Castro did that when he was censored by 3-2. In November, and you all three were wrong. You censored him because Maritza wants to think that she went to a workshop. Oh, we got to look at the, of course we have to look at the positive. We have to admonish also, since you're public servants, what you don't do. And I've always said it, Mr. Moreno's not getting reelected. I mean, Mr. Romero won't get elected. I think there's only one seat. I think Mr. Castro will, and I think Mr. Moreno. I don't think you're coming back, Mr. Romero, because you don't have people skills. You're detached, aloof, and as manifested by your ability to conduct a meeting, leaves a lot to be desired. When you're pushing for 9 and 10, and even this whole agenda, and I'm going to finish right. How much more time do I have, Mr. Moreno?
45 seconds.
You know? It's atrocious, pitifully terrible. You know, when you look at here and you see the reports, I don't think you went to college. I don't think you know what a report is. Because if you look at a summary, look at the summary of the Board of Supervisors IID. When they submit an agenda, this is high school stuff. But you can't tell the difference because you haven't gone beyond working for your dad, and you're lucky your dad gave you a job. You know, you couldn't have made it at a university. But you know what? I'm glad that you only have 4 months. Thank you very much.
All right. Now we'll go to the comments by council members. Mr. Hodge.
The comments that were made are well taken, are true.
Which part?
About the parks, specifically.
You want to clarify that one?
No, not yours, sir. No, I thought that was too personal. And it is frustrating and embarrassing as a city councilman. It's difficult. We all have difficult challenges, but it is absolutely true that our parks are in deplorable shape. And I keep hoping, and I'll try my best to take a leadership role, to make it happen, to raise the quality of our parks at least a standard. We don't have the basic amenities for parks. And I don't know what to tell my constituents. It's very difficult. But I commend the subcommittee with Councilman Castro and Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado, and I urge you, in any way that I can help also, or all we can help, that we move forward. We have to have a comprehensive strategic plan, but we have to have the will. We have to set it as a priority, because we just can't sit here and talk about it and then we don't do anything about it. We really have to care as a whole and move on this. I think we all agree. Our parks are not the best. And we're neglecting and letting down our families here, our citizens, and our children. On another note, too, and I'll pursue it later, is our bus stops. Mr. Savine, we have got to come up with a plan. I just don't want to see senior citizens or children with young mothers waiting in the heat, 110, 12, and there's no damn shelter. We have to do something. So my approach is to ask a city council staff and department heads. I'm big. My academic background is strategic planning, short-term, long-term, action plans. So I'll talk to you personally and take the lead on the bus stops. But going back to the parks, it is deplorable. And especially it's an embarrassment, the one that's right across the street from the police department. Right. Well, but it's also across the police department. And so we all have to take responsibility. And that's including me. So I'll step up and try to do my best. But we have to make it a priority. We have to make it a priority. The other issue, Mrs. Tollier, two concerned citizens that volunteer their time on arts and crafts at the community center for senior citizens, they really were urging me to speak up and ask you, can we get the senior citizens a television?
We're working on it.
Okay, so hopefully it's going to be done.
I actually presented a proposal to the Measure H committee to request funding for that, and I'm working on getting the copy of the minutes to bring it to you at the next meeting.
Very good. I think they like to enjoy.
The OA will like to donate that TV, sir.
Bless you. Okay, you heard it. The other issue, or the other areas, I really enjoyed Battle by the Border. Is that the correct title? You did an excellent job, emceeing. I was unaware. I thought this was the first time, but I was told 2 years ago they had it. Excellent job. And that just coincides with what I've been wanting to push. And I've talked to Councilman Moreno about it, and the city needs to step up. The citizens need to volunteer and do their parts for fundraising, but we should not back off and let them do all the work. The city has to contribute. So I just want to announce today that we should take steps to bring back a boxing program here in Calexico. Young men and women, children, they really get a lot out of the boxing program. It is one of the best things we can have here for our kids and keep them off the streets. So I'm just announcing that, and Mr. Moreno, maybe you and I can, or anybody out of the forces, and ask the city maybe a report, Mr. City Manager, on what are the possibilities? How in any way can we help these hardworking, tired volunteers that are trying to do their best? City needs to step up and help them. City's got to contribute. So those are the three items that I wanted to say, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Moreno.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And along the lines of Mr. Hodges' comment on the parks, I think for the first couple of years, Measure H has focused primarily on public safety. And the fire engines and the new police cars, well, not necessarily police cars, but I mean, we should now focus on the parks with the Measure H monies. If that's an idea that can happen. I think I agree that the parks are in pretty bad shape. It was a testament today with all these kids that are involved in the Parents Athletic League, Pop Warner, Little League. I've been out there at the Little League, at the Pop Warner, and I've seen the number of kids in this community that need better parks, better lighting. Our facilities need upgrading. And I think I challenge the Measure H committee to come up with that plan to look to improve the facilities. We've got great programs for our kids. We just need to work on the facilities. And I think if we direct our city manager to put a focus for the next fiscal year for what can Measure H do for our facilities, and I think that a year from now that maybe we would be looking at a better, our fields in a better condition. Also, I'm glad that the town hall meeting that Mr. Hodge, I know you forgot to mention, that was your pet project, was well attended by many residents from the west side of town. We thank the fire chief for allowing to use the facility, the firehouse on the west side of town. And a lot of information was given us. I thank Mr. Servine for taking copious notes and try to address some of the issues that we can out there on the west side of town. So the minutes that were in our package today were very, very detailed as to what needs to be done. And also, Lieutenant Gerardo, you were there taking notes and answering questions. With the success of this town hall meeting, I think that we should set up another one, possibly in October, to look at how our follow-up in October, that the staff and the council has developed a needs assessment on what needs to come first, and we need to set that up. I would suggest either the second or fourth Tuesday, no special meetings in October, to address those issues that were brought up in the last Tuesday in July, to see that some progress has been made and what progress needs to be made. Also, I want to thank the Adrian Cordova Foundation for their excellent production of Battle by the Border, their second one. That took a lot of work. Officer Fernando Lara, Germán Duran, and many of the police officers that were out there, also with your daughter Lily was there also. And they did an outstanding job. We had a lot of fun. I think we could coordinate that to come out when we don't have a Family Fun Friday, because I was wearing a tuxedo with patent leather shoes that were full of mud because the Fun Fest was the night before. I saw a lady fall, pobrecita. Hopefully we don't get a lawsuit. But congratulations to that outstanding event. And finally, I want to thank that the city streets. We've got some parking spaces out in front. We've got some stop signs throughout the city that have been painted, and some crosswalks that have been painted, and that will continue until we've hit the whole city. Is that right, Mr. Servine? Okay, well, thank you very much for having that. It puts the city in a more orderly flow of traffic and where people can park and such. So that's all I have, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Moreno. Mr. Castro.
It is sad and embarrassing that we're still talking about restrooms, parks. We've been talking about these issues. I suppose a lot of issues about parks and restrooms. What Mr. Casillas said a few minutes ago, he's right. He's right in regarding the parks and the restrooms, and everything is related to bad administration. Why? It is bad administration. Why? Because this has been happening for years, and I believe not all the my colleagues support those kind of issues, and those issues are very important, and that's the reason I've been mentioned something embarrassing, especially because people coming from out of town and they hear these issues and they say, I mean, that's something that I feel bad and embarrassing. In regard to bottles by the border, was a great event. I've been there, was especially it's a great event. Why? Because it's related to kids and youth, and what I think they did a great job. But yeah, it is a great, they did a great job. That's all, Mr. Mayor, I have to say.
Thank you, Mr. Castro. Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado.
I'd just like to say that I was out. I had surgery on the 27th, so thank you so much for holding down the fort on the 31st of July for the town hall meeting. I read the report, and it does look like there was a good amount of people that showed up, so it was a successful meeting. I also went to Battle of the Border my second year, and it was a great event. And out of the two, the first one that I went to this 2 years ago and this one here, actually, I think this one was even better. To respond to your comments, Mr. Castro, with regard to the fact that possibly your council members here are not considering the needs of the parks, well, I believe that's kind of unfair because yourself and I were on the committee, and we're on the committee to be able to then pinpoint our work for the parks, so that's why we have a committee. I know that I've been out for about a month, but I'm back to work, so I guess we can get together and we can continue doing our work. So I'm back in, and I'm feeling very healthy, so I'll be giving you a call to be able to continue that work. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
That's it?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado. To begin with, before I go to my own comments, I'll just note that the comments that were shared previously are more to a form of belief that there is a intent of success of these events that the staff is trying to accomplish for the benefit of the citizens of Calexico as a measure of a campaign from myself or any other council members that are running for re-election. You have been either misinformed or you're misinforming. I did hear comments that things like this were going to start, and so I was expecting them. Okay. I had a visit to Rodriguez Park, which had been requested by Gustavo Escobar. One of the things that, yes, I did identify that the park does need some serious attention. One of the things that I picked up that I thought it was curious that I took two tours around it. Maybe I missed it, but I didn't even notice where the dedication of the park is, especially the naming of it. I did note that the two tennis courts, one had a net, the other one did not. There's been some situations where a metallic mesh would be, maybe will serve, that would be less attractive than having a cord. That's some tennis players are more accustomed to having as a net. Anyway, Public Works Director Nick Servin, hopefully that you can look into that, see what can be done to improve that. I did notice some trees that were somewhat damaged. And this was a couple of weeks ago, and more so now probably with the winds recently. Okay. I have received comments to the following concern, and I wish to clarify that any council member, if any one council member has more authority than other council members, and no, including that as mayor, and with Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado. As mayor and Mayor Pro Tem, we serve the role of being the spokespersons for the remainder of the council while we maintain and protect the integrity of the whole and a majority of this council. No one member has more political clout than another. It takes no less than 3 members to have that, and that should only be addressed towards the city manager. At times, with no exceptions here, we lose focus that we must conduct ourselves in a manner that represents the council as a whole, staff, and the members of our community, and we mean all, and this refers to all of us and not just one. For me, I have made a private, and will now offer a public apology to Ralph Morales, his immediate boss, Nick Servin, and Nick's boss, City Manager Rodriguez. At the prior meeting, I was visibly frustrated on how the city has its criteria, an issue of issuing warning notices versus fines on one citizen's concerns regarding the trash cans. And I insisted that it be a warning and instead of a violation. But it should be a violation if the citizen does not respond to it within a reasonable manner or amount of time. The solution for further transparency and its clarity is, the problem is with the language. We need to work on the language, and that I will address it. I didn't have it noted down, but I'll address it with future agenda items. I would like to bring that language to for council consideration, where it be reworded, where the it's not a discretion at the code enforcer, but let it be where an initial violation be a warning, and any follow-up violations then mandate a citation. My apologies, Ralph, Nick, and Oscar. City Manager Rodriguez and our Public Works Director Servin, if you can share with us what is the status on the store that continues to have reminders of the Easter Sunday earthquake, what is taking so long on its improvements? It seems that nothing has changed since day one.
You're talking about the tanks.
What's the name of the store, Morris?
Melrose.
Oh, Melrose. Okay. Yeah, I think we have an update on that.
We've been coordinating and communicating with the owner and various leases out there to try to do something quickly. We're frustrated too, and the owner has assured us that he has some bids for doing the work, but again, we're trying to get them to move on this quickly.
Well, we got everybody else to move on them quickly. Why is the city not pushing on it as the city did for the other structures?
I can't say for sure, but we have been communicating with them.
If you can give us a report on the next council meeting, please.
Sure.
Also, Mr. Mayor, if I may.
Yes.
On the corner of 9th and Rockwood, there's a house that is burned, right, and I've got complaints from some of the citizenry out there.
There's an probe today.
And I know you did send an email, and we're going to look into it. Could you also bring us a report on that, what steps the city is going to take to
sure.
demolish that, or to get the owner of the bank to demolish it?
Yes.
Thank you.
Put a high wall around.
City Manager Rodriguez, is there, you're going to be presenting a budget in the near future for 2012-2013. Is there a line item there, either as a salary or contracting out the service for someone to serve as an economic development promoter or coordinator? Mind you, this is something back from 2000, well, I won't mention the year or the month, but this is something that's been a concern for some time now, and nothing has developed. Like any entity, it requires a salesperson for it to continue moving forward and not just wait for somebody to knock on their door. I hope that if you have not considered it, I hope you do before the budget is presented. Since Tuesday the 7th, let me see here, July 19th, there was a subcommittee meeting on downtown with bid chair Morris Risen, present with Advanced Services in regards to the maintenance to the downtown area. Meeting concluded to the satisfaction of bid's chair, and hopefully the maintenance will be properly maintained. Is that your recollection, Mr. Risen? Thank you. July 27th, I attended the SANDAC Committee on Border Issues held downtown in San Diego. The follow-up meeting will be until September. He was here. I don't see him. Supervisor District 1, John Renison, was also present. Where is he?
He's over here.
There you go. July 29th, I visited, well, I mentioned the Rodriguez Park. July 31st, I attended a meeting with other Valley members in regards to the Joint Strike Fighters Force, which is something that this council approved to support in some capacity. July 31st, Councilman Member Castro and yours truly were present at the JPA meeting with Heffernan Memorial, Primary Significance, Fire Department Chief Mercado, I believe, will be making a presentation to Heffernan for another ambulance. Now that your fire department is fully staffed or will be fully staffed, is that correct? July 31st, I was also, well, mentioned the town hall meeting, hoping that maybe the department heads that were present that received feedback from the public at the next town hall meeting, we can give a formal solutions to their concerns that they were presented at that time. August 2nd, Councilman Castro and Yersuli were present at the Neighborhood House microloan program supporting a Mexicali hot dogs restaurant at the corner of Grand and Cesar Chavez Boulevard. Wells Fargo Bank extended and has extended contributions to this program to help small investors get their businesses off the ground running so they can be part of the solution in decreasing our high unemployment rate. Thank you, Wells Fargo Bank and Berta Fletes, for sponsoring these opportunities by Neighborhood House and Ricardo Ortega's microloan program. August 9th was the eve of the filing deadline for candidates to run for several elected positions within our valley, more in particular, 7 filled for election to the City Council, including the 3 incumbents, John Moreno, Luis Castro, and yours truly. Other candidates vying for our seats are former mayor and council member David Luzan, former council member Guillermo Hermosillo, local businessman Eric Ortega, and school board trustee June Kim. Good luck, and hopefully it will be a clean campaign by all. Obviously, it didn't start that way today. August 9th and Monday the 20th, the Swimming Pool Committee has resumed having its meetings. It includes City Manager Rodriguez, Public Works Director Servin, Council Members Hurtado and yours truly, Superintendent Fragale, Trustees Duarte and Aguilar, County Supervisor Renison, Chamber President Hargrave, Calexico Enterprise Zone, Danny Fitzgerald, which will be extending invitation now to IED as well. August 10th, the goal is to have something in place for next summer. August 10th, a fundraiser was held to help finance a trip by Mr. Tony Tirado to the Democratic Connection Convention. My apologies for not attending. I was unavailable due to business reasons, and I hope it was a success. And that's it. So we'll go to the agenda, the consent. But before we do that, at the direction of the council, there was a request to move the consent calendar from the Calexico Redevelopment Agency successor agency to the beginning. Is that okay with the council?
It's fine with me.
That's fine.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yes.
Okay, City Attorney Lyon, can we move forward on this?
Yes, you can.
Okay.
It's item number 26.
It's item number 26, 27. Are we pulling number 28?
We're pulling number 26.
We're pulling number 26.
That to be put completely off the agenda tonight.
Off the agenda. Pull off the agenda.
And then number the addendum has a successor agency consent item. We can consider that number 29.
Okay.
It's regarding a property maintenance and remediation agreement.
Okay, can since the three are under the consent calendar, can we motion on all three, or do we separate
we'd like the one
from the regular agenda and the other, and then address the...
We'd like to address number 29 as a business item and keep the other two under consent. So we'd like to move 29 so we can discuss it and provide you a presentation and leave 27 and 28 under consent.
29 under business item.
It just said it, remove it from consent so we could discuss it. Keep the other two under consent. So we can take it after 28 if you desire to approve 27 and 28 as one motion under consent.
Okay. Well, Council, if there are no questions on items number 27 and 28 under the consent calendar of the Calexico Redevelopment Agency successor agency, is there a motion to approve both items?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved by Mr. Moreno, second by Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado. Please press the button to display your vote. Passes unanimously, 5-0. Okay, now we'll go back to the item number 29. We're going to address number 29 at this time.
29, yes. 29 is an item that we've been working on for quite a while to move forward the project that is known as Grand Plaza in order to hopefully create jobs and provide for sales tax revenue, which this community definitely needs. And so I'm going to introduce Steve Duquette, who has been working with our team as far as consulting on this particular agreement, which is a remediation and access agreement for the former gun club property. Steve.
Very good. Mr. Mayor, members of the council. Again, my name is Steve Duquette with Urban Futures, your economic development and redevelopment wind down consultant. And you often get to see my our company owner, Marshall Lynn, here. And he was unable to come tonight, so he asked me to stand in for him. So here I am. I've been with you before, so hopefully I look somewhat familiar to you. The matter of this evening before you is to approve a property maintenance and remediation agreement with Corsair LLC. And they are the developer of the Grand Plaza project that would be on the south side of 2nd Street. That would be west of the New River and immediately south of the Calexico International Airport. And in effect, this agreement would allow for the maintenance and remediation of, is to maintain the site and to remediate hazardous materials at this the property known as the former gun club property. This property at one time was owned by the city. It was acquired by the redevelopment agency. And because of the dissolution of redevelopment agency, it's now under the control of the successor agency. This particular property some years ago was looked at as an opportunity to become a portion of the Grand Plaza project. Because it was a small arms firing range, the property was examined by professional engineering geologists. And they developed what's called a phase two environmental analysis. You've heard of phase one, phase two, phase three. By the way, this agreement really is the phase three. Phase one is a review of record. Phase two is actual soil testing, and that was done at the time. And it was discovered, no surprise to anyone, given how the property was used, that there are lead fragments in the soil. This is from spent rounds. As a result of target practice, I believe the police department and maybe others may have used this site from time to time. That's no longer the case, but nevertheless, the remnants of lead are still on the property. Before the property can be reused, pursuant to the analysis that was done by the city's environmental geologist through the phase two, there needs to be what's called a phase three, which is the actual remediation and the removal of the soil that has this contamination. Now, how does this relate to your role as a successor agency? And I've made presentations to you about those kinds of matters in the past, and it's somewhat evolving. However, you might recall that as a follow-up to the state's initial action to dissolve redevelopment agencies, which was made during June 2011, then there was a Supreme Court case, and it was found that the one part of that transaction to enable redevelopment agencies to continue to exist was unconstitutional. Therefore, the dissolution process was to continue. And we began down that road. This last budget cycle, the state adopted a new AB 26, but it's a different number. It's AB 1484. It had a lot of additional procedures and processes included within it, including a program with respect to how do you ultimately dispose of property. And I'll mention that in just a minute. But in the intervening period of time, there's authority under AB 1484 to take actions with respect to maintenance or remediation and that sort of thing. This agreement falls under that authority. So your authority to enter into this agreement is contemplated under the authority in AB 1484, which added appropriate language to the California Health and Safety Code. Now, I mentioned Grand Plaza, Corsair LLC. They are proactively trying to pursue the development of the project. They understand that there is a procedure in 1484 that the successor agency needs to follow and given over to the state to figure out a complicated way to do it. But they've asked that a series of very highly focused audits occur. They're called due diligence reviews. First, for your housing fund, that has to be handed into the state by October 15th. And then for all other funds that are not housing, that has to be handed into the state after due process to you, Oversight Committee, public hearings, all that sort of thing. The state has to have that by January 15th. And they have until April 1st to determine whether the reviews were done properly. And by the way, what they're really looking for is uncommitted cash. They can find uncommitted cash. They want to sweep that to the auditor controller for distribution to the taxing entities, of which, of course, the city is one. If the reviews are done, if cash payments are due, they're made, then the successor agency, in this case, Calexico, would be eligible for what's called a finding of completion. Right after having a finding of completion, Calexico can then run through the process of finalizing a long-term property management plan, which, by the way, the law sort of looks at everything serially, and you would, pursuant to the law, you'd have 6 months after a finding completion to prepare the plan and get that through the approval process. Once that's in place, you can sell the land that remained is now with the successor agency. We'd actually, and we've been working with staff in this regard, we'd like to get ahead of the curve. So when the finding of completion is made, we want to be able to be in a position to file the property management plan as soon as possible thereafter. So we're looking at that happening next spring. Now that's a mouthful of words, and your head's probably spinning a little bit regarding, well, why all this process? Well, that would be the legislature and Governor Brown, not any of us. We would have never dreamed this up. Now, that brings us back to Corsair LLC. They have volunteered to take on the responsibility of cleaning up the site. And what they're asking for in exchange for following a prescribed program of remediation, and they have hired their own certified engineering geologist. The city already has one. They basically are overseeing this process, and they have an identical view of what needs to be done, by the way, which is very good news. Corsair has volunteered to do the work, expend the money, and then in the future, after your property management plan is in place, then they would hope to buy the land. By the way, the agreement you would enter into does not give them the legal right to buy the land. There's not authority to do that in the law, so there's a bit of a trust me guarantee. But I think you know who the folks are and that they really mean to do this, and it's a very significant economic development project for the city, producing lots of sales tax money, which I think some could be used for parks. I heard that discussion earlier, so that might be real helpful in that way, and maybe many others. So I know the Corsair folks are very interested in pursuing that. So what we have is an agreement that covers that. Because of a timing being of the essence, certain aspects of that agreement are still in flux. There's really three things in particular. I've discussed this with Mr. Ron Hawley of Corsair LLC, who's here this evening. I believe you know him. He might even want to make a few comments about where their project is in terms of the development cycle. He's always excited about doing that, and I'm always excited to hear it, as I'm sure you are. Anyway, they're interested in pursuing this under the auspices of this agreement. There are three things we need to work out. We just got the detailed review of what their engineer was going to do yesterday. It's this thick, it's all kinds of good stuff. I mean, it's super scientific. It's excellent work. It's about as thick as your environmental phase two assessment was. So we need to refine the scope of work in the agreement to be consistent so it matches the remediation plan. Discuss this with Ron Hawley. They are very eager to do that. We will work that out. Secondly, there is a dollar amount that's included in the agreement that would be theoretically the offset amount. In this agreement you have, the draft, the number is $293,000. After further review and looking at the report just submitted by the consultants for Corsair and reviewing material provided by the city's engineer, the number for the hard cost of doing this is about $240,000. There's some additional reviews required for independent verification by the city, which would add about $20,000. So the number will need to be $260,000. So the agreement will be amended to show that number, have a slightly revised work program to match the new work that was produced yesterday. And it will have some additional language that clarifies that the city's certified environmental or an engineering geologist of record who won't interfere with the work program but wants to independently certify for your benefit that the work program offered, in fact, is completed. We have no reason to believe that won't be the case, but just a few little wording adjustments need to be made to make sure that's clear. Now, in adopting the resolution this evening, you are conditioning the approval on the part of the city manager from you to sign the agreement on those matters being worked out. So that language is in the resolution so that the authority to sign is dependent upon doing this. I spent some time before this evening's meeting discussing that with Mr. Hawley, and we believe just in a matter of days we'll have that wrapped up. That can be signed, and then the agreement, and then the work program will begin as soon as possible thereafter, and we will be pleased to say sometime very soon that the site is completely clean, which is very important to the long-term liability that might accrue to the city if it were not. But this way, this gets done. And so it's very unusual to have a developer volunteer the money up front. They have done it. They're very credible to do that. I would say we're very appreciative of that offer. And that is the essence of what's before you. We agree with staff. We recommend that you adopt this resolution that would allow this agreement to be signed subject to those conditions. If you have any questions about what I have presented this evening, I'd be glad to answer those questions for you. And as I mentioned, Mr. Hawley's in the audience, and if you have questions of him, I'm sure he'd be happy to answer as well.
And with all that said, my Mr. Duquette, what this does is allows us to move forward on this project and clean up the site and give them access so that we can continue to move forward and hopefully see some bulldozers out there soon moving some dirt around. Before any other questions, I would like to introduce Tom Clark, who's in the audience. Tom is the attorney for the project. He's a straddling yoke of Carlson and Roth, and he's also part of our team that has been helping us move this forward.
Council members, any questions?
I say let's move forward.
Yes.
Mr. Mayor, I just want to clarify, there was a revised resolution that was provided to the council and put on the website yesterday. So if council takes action tonight, it will be that revised resolution. And then if council's going to make a motion, it would just be with the inclusion of the additional wording to the contract related to the independent review of the city's consultant.
I'd like to move on that, Mr. Mayor.
Okay.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Moreno, second by Mr. Hodge. Please press the button to display your vote.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good luck. Okay, we go back to the beginning.
Mr. Mayor. If you don't mind, I know Ron has a long trip back also along with these gentlemen. If we can move Ron up and he would like to give us a status on the project, that would be great. We can then send him on his way.
Oh, the item under informational items?
Yes, on the addendum.
Please. Mr. Hawley.
Thank you, Oscar. Mr. Mayor, members of the council, Ron Hawley, RH Properties, development consultant for Charles Company and Corsair LLC, owners of the project, of the property. You've taken a very huge step tonight, enabling us to move forward with starting construction. We have been pushing hard, and we've been working with Oscar and his staff and his consultants, and we really appreciate everyone's effort. Everybody has worked tirelessly trying to get through this red tape that we needed to go through and enable us to get started. The good news is we're continuing with our leasing program. I've provided a list of some of the tenants a month or two ago to Oscar that we've been working with. We have a number of leases signed, and one of the reasons that this was so important tonight was because we have performance obligations to those tenants. And if we don't perform, if we don't show substantial progress on not just commencing construction, but doing the things we need to do, then they could conceivably kill the lease. That's the last thing we want to have happen. So we have right now about 43,000 square foot of leases signed. That's six leases between American Eagle, Aeropostale, Nike, Coach, and Skechers. Nike and Coach, the other tenants are excellent tenants as well, but Nike and Coach are catalyst tenants, if you will. And what I mean by that is they kind of blaze the trail. If they go in a project, other discount outlet retailers will follow because they know the experience and the quality of Nike and Coach as being just impeccable. I mean, where they go, there's no failure. It's success, usually a skyrocket. So they're the people we have to demonstrate to that not only are we serious, but we're performing the things that we need to perform. Our grand opening schedule date is August 2nd, 2013. In order to make that date, we need to be under construction very soon, like literally within the next week or so. Right now we're having a little problem with a little pesky critter called a burrowing owl, and so we're trying to work through the issues of relocating their nests and so forth. We thought we had one, it turns out we have three or four. So we know where they are, and we're working through that with the consulting environmentalist biologist, and we'll get that problem solved here pretty quick. But the other issue that was stopping us was the gun club. With the resolution tonight, that clears the way to allow us to proceed. The tenants that I mentioned, all 65 tenants, is what we call our first phase, phase 1A. And that's 264,000 square feet of discount retailers, 40 to 70% off is a typical program. They will produce in excess of $100 million in sales. Actually, it's more like $120 million. Those are their projections, not ours. They're typically conservative, so we may be even able to eclipse that. In our wildest dreams, our initial projection, you may recall 2 or 3 years ago when I stood before you, I told you our sales were going to be around $140 million, which would produce sales tax of about $1.4 million. Well, if our first phase is anywhere close to what the tenants are projecting, we're going to double that. And our second phase, we hope to move into, actually it's phase 1B. I need to be clear because we have subsequent phases, as you know, they go down the road, go down the rest of the property towards American River or American Canal. Anyway, the total project will be in the 500,000 square foot range and should produce substantially ahead of what we were originally projecting. As I said, three times maybe in our wildest dreams, but I expect this to be a rocket. It's just going to go off. It's going to be so successful. We're already taking reservations for the second phase, phase 1A or 1B, and we will start commencing construction for 1B probably within 6 months, if not sooner, of when we open phase 1A. So we're excited and we're pumped. We couldn't be more ecstatic. So if there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer those. But thank you again for your cooperation and assistance. We very much appreciate it.
I have a question, Mr. Romero.
Go ahead.
A lot of these construction jobs that are coming up, I'd like to propose that or even challenge that a lot of our local construction workers be able to get positions and try to work at the site. I don't know if it's written in any language in the agreement, but we need our local people to get jobs.
Absolutely. We have a local hire program. We're not necessarily obligated to do that, but we do that as a matter of course.
Thank you.
So, you bet.
Any other comments, questions, council members? Thank you, Mr. Holly.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Congratulations.
Congratulations, yes. Okay, the one consent general fund item that's in the addendum, we can include it in this one as number 21 or
20A.
Okay.
On the RFP for bus shelters.
Okay. All right. Now I entertain a motion for the consent calendar items 1 through 20A.
I'd like to pull 10 and 11.
One moment, please. I'll pull item number 2.
Mr. Mayor, on that one, we were going to recommend that it be pulled off the agenda completely.
Number 2?
Number 2. There was some corrections, but the version before you is still not right.
So it'll be pulled from the agenda?
Yes, number two.
Number 20. Any other items, council members? No? Is there a motion to approve 1 through 9, 12 through 19, and 28?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, motion by Mr. Moreno, second by Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado. Please press the button to display your vote. Passes unanimously. Okay, let's go to yours, Mr. Moreno, number 10.
Yes, I think this is a good thing for the request for drinking fountains. However, I'm looking at the list, Mr. Servine, of the parks that are listed here. Some parks already have drinking fountains. I'm also looking at the use by the populace of the city of Calexico. And I know that what Mr. Risen had mentioned about Risen Park, and I live around there, that the use of that park is tremendous. Park retention basin, because there are other parks that are called parks or fields, but they're still retention basin and they're still used by our kids for the most part, and the parents and the families go out there. Risen Park, I believe, should be in the list, and maybe Rockwood Plaza already has drinking fountains. I think that is a critical area of use, and I feel that a lot of the kids would benefit by having a drinking fountain out there, and I'm not sure why it was left out, but I know it's used constantly. It was used in the summertime, it's used in the fall, it's used in the winter, it's used in the spring, and there's a lot more traffic out there. And people at night, there's lights out there, and they walk around the track. And so I would venture to say the ones that are used the most should get some of the amenities that that the city is offering. So I would like to know if we can include Risen Park to benefit from this $25,000 include a drinking fountain.
I had that discussion already, and I'm looking into that to see what the language says, how much we can modify from diverting from the actual list. The list was prepared some time before I got here, okay. And so I took the ball and I ran with it.
Yeah, I also got Heber Park. Heber yes. Park is a nice little park out there. I guess it's the end of the Christmas parade, the beginning of the Christmas parade. But other than that, the use is very limited.
Yes.
So I want to make sure that Risen Park is included at all costs because of the use and the kids that are out there.
If the council so desires and wants to give direction, we can certainly include it. What the situation is that this grant was approved in 2009 and basically had a two-year life on it. And Mr. Servine and myself were not here. We asked for an extension. We were able to get extension from the state. But I think the easiest thing to do, because it's not a costly item, is to just simply bring it back with funding from another source and get it done, rather than to try and change these state agreements that we've already asked for an extension.
Okay.
So if your council so desires, we can do that.
If I may, there is a subcommittee with two council members, Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado and Councilman Castro. Were they brought in any of the discussions?
Well, as I said, this was awarded back in 2009.
No, I know that, but I'm talking about when the discussions were were taking place again.
No, because I started this sometime shortly after I started, so the committee wasn't even started.
Okay. Anything else, Mr. Moreno, on item 10?
Well,
or was that a cover for both?
Now that I come to think of it, I know there's another park that is also used by a lot of the community members, and it's one of the newer parks. That's Cordova Park, and it's not on there. And I look at Nosotros, which is a big one. Emilia, I'm not sure where Emilia Park is. Rodriguez, of course, is a Babe Ruth field. Las Casitas is over there. They practice Little League out there. We know Heber, Kennedy Gardens. Cortez is a basketball court on 2nd Street. The Community Center Park. Crummett Park, which is, I guess, our flagship. But we'd also like to see if we can include Cordova Park, too, as well. I think these are highly used by the members of the community. And I know that Cordova, for whatever reason, maybe in an upscale neighborhood that may not attract it, but let's take a look at that anyway.
Sure.
Thank you.
I will.
Is there a consensus from council to move forward so I don't have to bring it back? I mean, I don't know if I can do this. No.
No.
We will look at it, and unless somebody comes to my office and tells me, no, don't do it, I'm going to move forward with that. Yeah, because it just doesn't make any sense to delay this. This is way overdue. We can include that. It isn't a large item. We'll find the funding somewhere, and then we can bid it out at the same time and get it done.
So motion to
approve? Yeah, do a motion because it's not on the agenda. Oh, I'm sorry, to approve this. Yes, I'm sorry.
Unless anyone else has a comment.
No.
Okay, motion to approve, Mr. Mayor.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion by Mr. Moreno, second by Mr. Hodge. Please press the button to approve, I'm guessing, 10 and 11?
Yeah, on both.
Yes.
I'd like to include some of those two parks on 11 as well.
Okay.
Rising and Cordova.
All right. Passes unanimously. 5-0. The only thing that I have on the acknowledged receipt of the business delinquency list as of October 8th, 2012, Mr. Quinn, I'm sorry, August 8th. No, I'm going to the future. Number one is this report was placed under consent calendar. Please don't place it here in the future. Put it under informational item. One of the things that have been discussed is how do we know that these fees, there's business license fees, and fees that are owed to the fire department or for the efforts by the fire department. I understand these two fees are mixed in into these the list that you provided.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, the report that prints out that you get a copy of is really a spread, and it's an Excel spreadsheet. And among the columns that are on the, or at least in the raw report, are the fire fees. But when we print that report out, because the fire fee is an integral part of the business license code or fee, we hide some of the columns to leave room on the page. It's really a matter of fitting them, being able to fit the information on a page, and the fire fee for purposes of the delinquency report on the business license fee would be extra information. So what we're offering to do is to print a separate report. It would be essentially the same format, but it would only include the column for the fire fees.
I guess I'll address this with the city manager. Is there any, the city moving forward on any language so the code enforcers can have more teeth to have the business get these business license fees get current, so they can get current?
Well, we're trying a couple of things. I know the next step that we're taking is there's a finance director has advised me that we're sending out some letters to see if that will move them. We also do have what we talked about in the past, where we would have to run it as a misdemeanor offense. So we have that available. At that point in time, it would become a criminal violation. So we'd have to go that route. So we're trying everything we can to try to collect them prior to having to go to that route. We certainly I don't know if legal has any comments on this as to what, how we can change it and whether we can actually close down their business or not. And maybe that's something that we should look at.
Closing down the business is likely going to it is going to require court action. So we would probably need to talk to the council on a case-by-case basis with respect to how you want to initiate legal action related to closing down businesses. As far as issuing notices of violation and citations, administrative citations, even criminal citations, those can be done administratively.
We have one total here, and this is not including the, which is this? There's one here that the business owed over $300,000, and I'm not including the other reports. And some of these, okay, Mr. City Manager, it's page number 2, 3, 4, 5. Oops, one more, 6. To the right, the middle. No, $300,000. They owe for 2012, 2011, 2010, 2009. Are you following the page where the amount shows?
I'm honestly not sure what page you're talking about.
It's page 7, I believe.
Page 7?
Yes. Where it separates one sector of the businesses to another. 2, 3, 4, 5, page 6.
Mayor, you're talking about the $327,524.
Is that a total?
Yeah, that's a total. Oh. That's of the business sector.
Okay, that's a total, and it's not an individual.
That's a total.
That's the total of all the licenses.
It's a running total of all these businesses that are here. Okay, right. The running total of all the businesses that are listed there. Correct?
That's a total of, I think there are about over 200 businesses that make up that total.
Now, there are some businesses that are listed here that no longer exist, and that's not an immediate concern. Whereas the concern is that there are some businesses that do exist, and there has been much of an effort to get things collected. You say you sent out a letter. We hope that that will start something. Businesses are demanding services. And one of the things is that if the business sector is demanding a certain level of services from the city of Calexico, they also have to contribute to these obligations. And that's where I'm asking how the city is going to go forward. I'm not requesting an answer right now, but just to make sure that it goes forward on this. Thank you. Yes.
Mr. City Manager, you mentioned letters go out, correct, sir?
That's the next step we're taking.
Help me again understand code enforcement. They go out and do the code enforcement first?
They do a citation, correct.
They do the citation?
Well, they do a warning first and try to get them to come in and pay, and then they go back and then they do a citation. Is that correct?
Again, and how many code enforcements do we have out there?
We currently have 2 full-timers, and then we use a part-timer when he's not doing development work.
Would you not say that that's a big area that needs to be improved on in order for us to improve on collecting these late business fees, licenses? Yes or no?
Well, I think the issue is more the actual collection rather than the citation. We can cite everybody, but if we can't collect it, it doesn't do any good. So we have to work on the collection process and what is the ultimate for that collection. Even if we turn them over to a collection agency, if they don't collect it, it doesn't do any good. And so that's why the question always becomes, okay, do you issue a criminal offense? Do you try to close them down? That's the ultimate that you can do.
But does not the act of citation put pressure, hopefully, on these businesses to to come in line and pay, hopefully?
Well,
starts the
some of them
process.
Do, and I don't have the numbers in front of me, and from now on, we certainly will be providing those in reference to a gauge as to where were we on the delinquency list February 1, which is when all the delinquencies occur, because they have 30 days from the beginning of the year to establish that delinquency, and then where are we today, so that you can get a better read. Because if you look at these numbers, the total, I don't know what the total is on this whole thing with everybody, but if we were a delinquent, if our delinquency list was twice as much February 1, then obviously we're making some progress. And so that, I think, is what we need to show you. Are we making progress on this or not? Some of these, a citation, they will come in and pay. Some of these, a citation doesn't move them very much. So,
well, then the question is, how important is code enforcers? Do they not help generate these fees to be paid?
Well,
yes or no?
Well, again, you're going to get some people that will pay. You're going to get some people that it's going to take more than just a citation.
Is, do we have a more of a comprehensive, systematic plan, strategic plan, using code enforcers going out and enforcing? Or is it just done wherever they're at, randomly or on spot? Or
well, they maybe I better call on the person who handles code enforcement, because my understanding is they go through this list and they start taking the actual businesses that are further behind and start hitting those first.
So,
but I'm gonna wait for the person who handles code enforcement to be able to answer that, so I don't
and to take
misspeak
account,
here.
City Manager Rodriguez, the amount, the total amount that's there has not decreased very much. I think there was a phase there of 1 or 2 months when businesses came in and started paying. But the 300,000 there, above 300,000, has been just about the whole year.
Okay, well, what we'll do, just to make sure, we will send something out in reference to what our delinquency list was February 1 and where we're at today, so that we all are talking about the same numbers. But in reference to how we go about it, why don't I, as the individual who actually handles the code enforcement officers, tell you.
My concern, Mr. Morales, is do we have some type of comprehensive strategic plan for code enforcers?
What code enforcement does is they've taken the list and they've gone through the list and visit the businesses. They were given a warning that they need to come in to bring their business license current. If they fail to do so, then that's when code enforcement goes back and issue a citation. Like the city manager said, you have some businesses that will come in once you provide them a warning. There's others that will come in once you issue a first citation. There's others that will wait until they get a
right.
second citation, and then there's others that just won't come in. Unfortunately, the authority that the code enforcement has is to go out there and issue the citation. We have no authority to close them down. We have no authority to do anything else besides that.
But it's the first pressure point, right?
Yeah, yes, it is.
This process.
And we have been able to make a dent on the list. Now, the list that you have here, there is a large amount of businesses that are closed. So if you look at the numbers of the dollar amount, and that's something that I've been working on, it will be reduced quite a bit because there are a lot of businesses that are no longer in existence.
Mr. City Manager, did I hear you right? You said that one of the priorities is that we attack first the ones that owe the highest fees or most delinquent?
That's my understanding. That
well,
we
basically what we did is we went out there and we tried to canvass the area. What we basically did is we went and took the list and we broke it down by areas.
Ah.
First, second, third street. And that's the area we
covered. That's what I was going to suggest.
Yes.
Maybe we fragment
it,
mark up the city, and hit one area in a
yes.
concentrated effort.
Yeah, because
saturate.
The other way, we do it the other way, there may be a problem that there will be those businesses that fall through the cracks, and maybe we don't go and
thank
visit
you for
those.
The information. I just wanted to make sure that we had some real substantial plan
yes.
of attack on this.
You can't simply go door-to-door, next door that's open?
Excuse me?
Go door to door.
If you're going through the list, picking here, picking there, and picking whatever, you are going to fall some.
Yes.
They're going to fall between the cracks. But if you start on First and, what's that, Pollen?
Mm-hmm.
And just move south or move east or move west, you're going to have some success.
Yes.
Not only with approaching the businesses that still owe the fees, but you'll be able to identify which businesses are there, well, that are no longer there.
And that's what we've been doing.
But you haven't eliminated anybody from the list.
There has been
businesses that are no longer there.
Yeah. I kind of feel that we have, like I said, there's businesses here on this list that are non-existent. They've closed their doors.
Yes,
so,
but if you're mailing a letter, and they don't exist, you don't. There's not going to be a response. This is why you need to go on, foot patrol. Anyway, I just wanted to go on.
Okay.
If nothing,
Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. And if nothing else, I'll motion to approve.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor, please press the button to display your vote. Okay, 5-0. All right, we'll go to General Fund Departments, business item number 21, discussion related to appointment process for the city clerk and city treasurer due to the tremendous workload. In the city clerk. Director, city manager, for further information and staff.
Basically, this item comes back to you. As you know, the voters went ahead and approved the two propositions we had before them, which asked the question of whether or not these two positions should be elected, continue to be elected, or be appointed. And the populace decided that they wanted appointed. So what you have before you tonight is who is going to make those appointments. Right now, I believe it is the city council, unless they provide that authority to the manager and put him under the staffing that he has responsibility for. I don't know if the city attorney wants to add any further information on this.
This is essentially a policy decision about where you want to make the appointments, or whether you want to have the city manager do it. I guess the only thing I want to point out is that regardless of who is going to make the appointment, I would suggest bringing an ordinance back that would specify that these positions are now at-will positions, appointed positions, subject to contracts, if that's the direction the council would want to go. But just clarify, because it has been an elected position for over 100 years now, so we just want to make sure that the municipal code clearly contains what these positions are. And I did try to do a brief survey of some of the cities in Imperial County and San Diego County about trying to get an idea of whether the council appoints or the city manager appoints, and there's not a clear winner. Every city tends to do it differently. We weren't able to find all of the municipal codes in Imperial County online, and so I'd say the majority, well, Hopeville, Brawley, and El Centro, El Centro, the city manager is the treasurer, so they don't have a separate treasurer. And from what we found in their municipal code, the city clerk is appointed by the city council. Brawley, the city clerk is elected. And it's not clear who appoints the treasurer, but it's not the city manager in Brawley. Hopeville, the city council appoints the city clerk. The city manager does not appoint either the city clerk or the treasurer. And Calipat, Imperial, Westmoreland, those were not online. The majority of cities in San Diego County have an appointed city clerk, and it's done by the city manager, not the city council. And then the treasurer position is the one that's some cities don't have a separate city treasurer. They combine it with either the city manager or the finance director. So again, it's just a policy decision, and we're just looking for input on what ordinance you want us to draft.
So in essence, either the city manager appoints, excuse me, Mr. Mayor, or the council. Can we just reappoint Ms. Cordova? No, she doesn't want it? Okay. I think for for it to be more of a team concept, I think that the city manager should have that right to appoint, because we're all changing for the most part on, you know, could happen, but maybe the stability lies within the city manager. I don't know. This is an interesting question.
The for my part, and being again that Lily doesn't want to resume her position there, but from my perspective, I think the appointment of the city clerk should be now at the discretion of the city manager, since the city clerk has the responsibilities of issues of the agendas, the minutes, the work, everything that is involved with it, and obviously that person needs to be under the direction of the city manager to make sure everything is completed and done within a reasonable time frame. The thing for me with the treasurer, it's different. It's like having, with all due respect, Mr. Quinn, having the finance director also serve as a treasurer, and if there's an issue to discuss as far as finances, I'd like to be part of that discussion between you and, you might say you serving both roles is how you're going to come up to a better conclusion. I would think that as far as for the treasurer, it should be a second person, not somebody that can sit down with the finance director and maybe share concepts and ideas. Now, you mentioned, I believe, that one of the cities has the city manager as a treasurer. That would be more okay for me, since we all know that Oscar is strong with numbers, or it could be anybody else within the staff. Obviously, the idea is not to go necessarily outside, because obviously they will, well, we just don't want to go in that path anymore. This is from my perspective. Mr. Hodge?
Well, to begin with, I was sort of leading at the very beginning that they should be still be elected by the people, so that they had...
I would have been in favor for that, the treasurer to be elected
that,
by the people.
That is long gone, so here we are.
Well, the people decided that they should
I know
be
that, and I was hoping that they'd go the other way, personally. Anyway, so be it. My feeling is that we've lost sort of a democratic process here, so at least let's have some inkling of a democratic process. So I don't know. I have mixed feelings about this. I don't know how we would do this, but the council should have some input. We should definitely have some influence. It makes me nervous, just one individual, whether right or wrong or how expert that person is. You mentioned a team effort. Well, that would include us, so I don't know whether we...
Maybe an appointment by the city manager, approval by the council?
Yeah, I mean, there should be a strong dialogue in interplay between, you know, who he has in mind and what we think about it. We should know and be informed, and we should be able to give our input. But I'm sure that probably was going to happen anyway, right, Oscar? Okay.
If I may add that, and just as thought came in, is it possible that the financial advisory commission maybe serve as the treasurer, since in some regard they're there to evaluate finances in some capacity. Would that be obviously that would be out of the norm, but would that be an avenue that could be taken into consideration? Now, to the comments that Councilman Hodge just mentioned, is it possible, if the consensus of the council is to go one way with the clerk, is that maybe continue to discuss how we go forward with the treasurer? For example, if there's a motion for the clerk to be appointed by the city council, giving the authority to the city manager to make the appointment for the city clerk, let's just, for example, let's just go forward with it, and continue to discuss the item on the treasurer. Can we address one and address the other one later?
Yes, you can, because they are two separate positions, so you don't have to go the same way on each position. I would just suggest that, I would prefer that we bring this back then for discussion on the city treasurer at the next council meeting, with some follow-up if the council requests it, because we do need to get new ordinances in place before November 6th when the terms expire on the current positions, so that we have a plan moving forward and you'll be able to make appointments to those positions if you need to.
So if the council wishes, it can motion for an approval for the clerk to be at the direction of the city manager.
Yes, because right now tonight you're just giving me direction to draft the ordinance.
Right.
And so I can draft the ordinance on the clerk and bring that back on September 4th for you to actually do the first reading. And then another agenda item will be this continued discussion on what happens to the city treasurer position.
And hopefully the council can make a decision by that time. So is there a motion by this council?
Well, I think we give her direction. I think that's the way to go.
Then?
I'll second that motion.
You'll second that direction?
Direction.
Okay, that's a direction for you to bring up language for the city clerk to be as an appointment by the city manager and to bring the treasurer position back so we can further discuss it.
Are there any other ideas regarding the city treasurer position that you want staff to investigate for your discussion on the 4th?
Well, I think the position of the city treasurer would be more of a checks and balances of the finance department, am I correct, Mr. Romero? Then maybe that should be a concept that we need to take a look at, of getting someone from the outside, with accountancy background.
Right. Well, anyway, the one possibility would be even be the city manager.
Okay.
So,
okay.
The idea is just to bring. Let's come to a conclusion for the clerk and see what we can.
We'll just list as many options as we found. Okay.
Right. Okay, so that's it for item 21. We'll go to item number 22, approval of professional services agreement with AECOM, AECOM, or Calexico Airport Master Plan, environmental assessment review. Approval of agreement with Corsair LLC for reimbursement of costs for the professional services and authorization for city manager to execute the agreements. City manager?
Public Works will address this item.
Thank you.
As you well know, the Corsair wants to, the Grand Plaza, wants to modify the location of the 2nd Street in order to expand their area. And by consequence, they're going to be doing some of the environmental, the design on their dime. So there's no involvement as far as monetarily from the city. The Corsair Grand Plaza wants to hire their own consultant. They are allowing the city to oversee and run that consultant and. Corsair, or excuse me, Grand Plaza is going to pay for hiring that consultant. So really this consultant is going to do the environmental required to modify the road location from where it's planned right now.
I think the only information I would add is that there are no guarantees with them putting up the money for us to hire this firm in order to run parallel to look at the option of whether or not that roadway should move or not. I think we're all in consensus that if we could do that without jeopardizing our FAA money and not jeopardizing the timing on this project, then I think that we all probably want to see that happen because it'll give more ability to bring in retail trade. But by the same token, we want to make sure, and I think everybody understands on talking to them, that if FAA comes back and says, no, that's not possible, then that's the end of that one. Or if, in fact, our money starts becoming jeopardized, our grants are jeopardized, then that's the end of that story. But again, the idea is to run these options parallel, so if in fact we do get FAA approval, and if in fact our money is not jeopardized, and if in fact we can do this, then we do it, because it's to everybody's advantage. And they will be providing the money to reimburse us the money, or putting up the money like we have in our other agreements up front, so that we can pay this.
Okay, so approval of this, then they would upfront the money to pay the service, okay? Attorney Lyon, anything you wish to add?
No, not at this time.
Okay. All right, council members, any discussion on this?
I think it's time we motion to approve and get this thing going. This is the third part of the whole shebang.
Second.
All right, that was your motion to approve, and second by Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado. Please press the button to display your vote. Passes unanimously, 5-0. Approval of resolution of City Council on the City of Calexico supporting the preparation of an Imperial Integrated Regional Water Management Plan through an open, participatory, collaborative public access. City Manager?
I think I'll apologize first to Antonio Ortega. I should have brought you up on the agenda. I know you love to come to council meetings in Calexico, so I know you don't have a problem with this. But I want to introduce Antonio Ortega, who is a governmental affairs specialist for the Imperial Irrigation District. And basically, in a nutshell, and he'll provide us some history and some details on this particular item before you vote on it. It's basically put us at the table. So we're a stockholder. We should be at the table to find out what the plan is and how to manage water. If in fact, and I'm sure he'll address this, if there was ever a shortage or if we didn't have the capacity, they cut down our allotments or whatever, then there has to be a plan that gets put in place as to how it's going to get distributed and so on. So we really need to be at the table to be able to provide our comments to that. With that, again, I'll introduce Antonio Ortega, and he can give us a little bit of history on this before you vote on what the request is. And we are supporting the request.
Welcome, Mr. Ortega.
Good evening. Council members, Honorable Mayor Romero, Antonio Ortega, once again, a reintroduction of myself. I most of you recognize me from my former capacity working with our local assembly member, but now I'm here representing the Imperial Irrigation District. But even further than that, today I'm representing the Imperial Region Water Management Group. And out of respect for the public's time and your time as well, I'm not going to go into the specific details of the Integrated Regional Water Management Plan. It's about 14 chapters. The executive summary alone is about 24 pages. So what I will do is just provide you with some brief summary, and I think your staff did an excellent job preparing the resolution that is before you this evening, where it does explain what the Integrated Regional Water Management Plan is for the city, for the county. But more specifically, what does it mean for you all here at the City of Calexico, and why is it that we're asking the City Council to support this process? Essentially, what this all boils down to is that as a region, the Colorado River Basin or Colorado River Region encompasses all of Imperial County, and the Department of Water and Natural Resources at the state level, through its Proposition 84 and 1E, establish a grant funding cycle that would trickle down to those local agencies and local cities and counties for all water and wastewater management projects or future projects that will be required in our communities, again, to integrate our water resources and manage the resources that we have and allocate them best to where they are needed. So what that means for you all is that if the City of Calexico, like the other cities have already done, becomes a stakeholder in this process, then in the future, for any funding that comes through the state via grants, the city may apply for those grants because you are a member of the IRWMP, again, Imperial Integrated Regional Water Management Plan. So what that means is that by March of 2013 is the round two funding cycle of Prop 84,
and $5.5 million are specific to the Colorado River region, again, which encompasses all of Imperial County. For round three of that funding cycle, which closes in the spring of 2014, that number goes up to $14 million. And again, we just want to ensure, and by saying we, I mean the city of Calexico with the other cities, Imperial County and IID, we want to ensure that you guys are at the table and that you, if the need arises for you to draw some of those funds for any projects that you have here in your city or that are planning, then this is the vehicle that will allow you to do that. So if you have any questions, I will entertain them at this time. If not, again, just asking you for your support of this process. I will be back before your board or before your council in the next 6 months. Right now, this project is already nearing completion. We have the draft public documents available to you at and to the residents on our website and even at all the city libraries. There's a hard copy, but if we don't receive any further comments and we don't need to make major reviews or edits to this document, we will be back before you again just for a final adoption and to present that to you before the end of the year. And again, just asking you for your support.
Thank you, Mr. Ortega. Any questions by the council members?
I move to approve the resolution, Mr. Mayor.
Second.
City Attorney Lyon, any concerns regarding this resolution?
No, I discussed the provisions of it with the city manager today, so.
Thank you. Be it that there's a motion by Mr. Moreno and second by Mr. Castro, please press your button to display your vote. Passes unanimously, 5-0.
Thank you.
We'll go to item number 24, appointment by City Council Member Moreno to the Beautification Committee.
Have we received any applications? Norma, you want to be on it? No. I'm going to try to recruit someone.
Okay, can we table this then for the...
I'm sorry.
Continue this on the next council meeting?
Sure.
Caldi? Yeah, that's table.
Okay. We'll go to item number 25, informational item only. Presentation on home grant application process. Terry Nava?
Yeah, there you are. Terry will be presenting this item. This item came up at your last meeting and you asked us to bring back some information. So
correct.
That's what we're doing today.
Are you ready, Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, Terry Nava, housing manager for the city of Calexico. Per your request, the staff and I have put together this slideshow for you, explaining to you the process of the Home Investment Partnership Program application. I would request.
May I interrupt you, Ms. Nava? We're all here except Mr. Hodge, and he had a lot of questions regarding this. Mr. Castro, can you check if Mr. Hodge is in the lobby, please? He had a lot of questions regarding this presentation.
Maybe in the men's room.
Yeah, pull him out of there. Let's take a speaker in there.
Well, this was his item, huh?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Well, he had a lot of questions, so I requested the for the presentation.
What? Let me do my presentation.
There he is. Okay, please resume.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, per your request, I will be providing this brief presentation to you on the home investment partnership program applications, and I would request that questions be held to the end so that we can get through the presentation, and that way we can focus on questions at the end. What type of funding is available? Grant funding is available on a competitive basis for eligible activities. These funds are awarded to the city to provide for approved projects in the form of loans to be repaid to the city. Eligible activities include rental projects, new construction with or without land acquisition, so that we may develop a multifamily project on a specific site with a specific developer. There's also rental rehabilitation, with or without land acquisition, to rehabilitate a specific rental project without a transfer of ownership, meaning if a developer applies for rehab of their property, they maintain their ownership of the property. Other eligible activities are first-time home buyer projects, new construction or acquisition rehabilitation conversion to develop home tracts for first-time home buyers. Why is funding available? The federal and state program is designed to develop viable communities by providing decent and affordable and sanitary housing for low-income families in our city of Calexico and other cities throughout the state of California, but we're focusing on Calexico. Who may apply? Home funds are available to local governments and nonprofit organizations certified as community housing development organizations, also known as CHODOs, on a competitive basis. The city must be the applicant for these grant funds. Upon review and approved project proposal, city staff and the developer coordinate to complete the application. Funds are awarded to the city for specific projects and administered by city staff. We will now be discussing the time frame to apply. A notice of funding availability, known as a NOFA, is released to the email through an email alert list and placed on the California Department of Housing and Community Development website annually. Normally, these NOFAs come out the end of May or the beginning of June. The NOFA explains the application process and required documentation, as well as the scoring system used to determine which projects will be funded. Interested qualified developers may sign up at the website through HCD to be placed on the Housing Community Development email alerts list. Additionally, there are home programs and Project NOFA application workshops available at no cost to interested parties who wish to attend to gather more information on the actual NOFA process. These workshop dates and locations are listed on the NOFAs. How to submit a project for funding consideration? The city is approached by a developer with a project plan complete with project cost, proof of site control, proposed financing plan, and specific supplemental financing needed to complete a specific project. A developer must show experience in past project to be considered in the ranking and rating of this process. After city staff reviews the proposal and submits to city submits the proposal to city council for approval, the developer and the city staff work together to complete the application. It is the developer's responsibility to provide all financial documents required for the application. The city then reviews the application and submits it to the home program for funding consideration. The deadline to submit applications is specified on the NOFA, and it's usually around mid-August. Our application that we just submitted went in last Friday. The NOFA process from being accepted by the council and authorizing us to apply is normally about 90 days after the release of the NOPA to submit the applications. So the time span is very, very short. To come to council, review the process of the NOPA, request that the project be accepted for approval to submit to the actual, to HCD. Projects must be financially feasible to be considered for funding. Site development issues, local government approvals, development cost, project timing, project market, staff experience in administering grants, and other development factors will be evaluated in order to make this determination. Projects may not be considered feasible if information presented in the application results in unknown or uncertain project cost or timelines. Projects must have site control. There must not be any pending litigation that could affect implementation of the project as proposed. Award letters are usually sent out some part the first of the year, usually in January. Benefits to our city. These projects enhance the quality of life through the development and preservation of healthy and balanced affordable housing for the less fortunate of our community. Construction of the project provides a boost to the local retail economy and creates jobs. Grant applications that are awarded to the city include funding for administration of the grant. These funds are used to offset the expense of staff salaries spent on time administering the grant. In addition, the city also receives revenues from building permits, plan check fees, and developer fees. So not only does the housing staff receive funding for administering the grant, but our building and engineering departments also profit from this. Funds expended by the city for awarded projects are considered loans to the developer and are to be repaid to the city home account. Monies received as repayment of these loans are then available for use by the City Housing Division for future home program activities. In addition, city staff holds an annual public hearing in July to discuss all housing program funds available for the next fiscal year. For further information pertaining to housing grants, please call 760-768-2177, and you may speak to any of the housing staff. There's only two of us left, but you're more than welcome to call either one of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Terry. Councilman Hodge, you had a lot of questions at a prior council meeting regarding this program. I'm hoping that this was informational.
Hoping that they answered all those questions.
Anyway, it was very understandable, follow through. Council members, any City Manager Rodriguez, any other comments from your part?
No, as you can tell from the presentation, it's a lot that goes into the application. Did you bring the application that was just filed?
I left it on my desk.
Okay, we just filed the application that we came to you for authorization to file last Thursday, Friday. And again, as you will recall, this is our second time that we're submitting this application. So it is very, very complex and very, very competitive. And given the economic situation, it's even getting more competitive each and every day. And so there's a lot that goes into trying to put one of these projects together. A lot of times you don't get funded the first time. It takes two or three times before you even get funded.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yes, go ahead, Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado.
Just to be able to understand the process a little further, the page that talks about how to submit a project for funding consideration, the last sentence says the developer experience in past projects is considered in the ranking and rating process. Who handles the ranking and rating? The city?
No, the city submits the application along with the developer, and the ranking and rating is handled through HCD, Housing and Community Development, at the state level.
Okay. So then what you're saying is that the city of Calexico has nothing to do with the success that the developer will have to be approved. Well, they do because you're hand-in-hand helping to prepare the application, but there's no determination made by the city to know if this person is going to be approved by the state program?
What we do is when a developer approaches us, in reference to trying to do a development, we look at the different guidelines that the state is going to be using in order to decide whether or not to continue to work with developers, because we didn't provide you with a copy of the actual application. We'll be happy to do that. It is all of 199 pages, I can tell you, because I read it. And in there, it's very detailed on how you go about it, such things as a developer's experience. It's very, very crucial in the scoring of the point system in reference to, have they done any projects in the past? Have they gotten awarded any projects? Have they had a problem with the construction of the projects? So it's very detailed because it's so competitive that they're looking for people who have done this. And one another section in the whole application is the funding. What is your funding? And normally it isn't one funding source. In fact, it never is one funding source, because you have developer, the developer has to defer his fees a lot of time, because there isn't enough into the project to be able to pay him off up front. So they do, we have what's called developer deferral of fees. Then you have the home application. In this particular case that we submitted was $4.6 million, and it was a $12 million project. And then you have tax credits, and then you have mortgage funds that you can get through the banks. So it's a very, very complicated system of ranking and rating by the state. So we obviously have to do our due diligence up front when we talk to somebody about making sure that they're going to qualify and obviously going to score well, because we're competing with a lot of different agencies throughout the state.
Thank you.
Okay.
Any,
can I
yeah, go ahead.
Because when we had that meeting and there was so many different negative comments made towards the company that was applying for the grant, I believe that if when I was looking at what was going on and seeing the different negative comments, I believe that part of the issue is, why is it that certain companies were the only ones that were applying? But as you just showed us now, anyone can go to this website, and anyone that feels they want to be in that competition for these funds can apply and know when it's available and has all that access. Does the city, or any city actually, usually have an active participation in promoting that people come to that website and apply?
Well, if you look on the last page, I think I discussed that in July we have a public hearing, and all of the housing programs are discussed at that public hearing. It's not necessarily before council, but it is a public hearing that we are mandated by the state to provide annually to discuss potential funding for the city. So that is all discussed in July. You're all welcome to attend. I do send out public hearing notices. They're in the newspaper. They're posted throughout the city, so we do provide that access so that everyone's aware of not just the home application, but all of the funding available to the city for housing programs.
So it's an open opportunity for anyone. It's just not anyone is coming and approaching and applying. We only have certain groups, certain companies that are approaching because no one else does.
Correct.
Sure, go ahead.
Well, I think Chelsea does a good job. They get results. It's just my background. The word monopolize or monopoly bothers me in the sense of what I understand what a democratic process is. So I still ask the question, why only Chelsea? But again, let me learn. Are there other companies that go on the list, but they just don't make the grade?
Actually, since I've been here for the last 2 years, Oscar and I did meet with a couple of other developers, and honestly, their response to us as to why they didn't want to move forward with the application is because their numbers didn't pencil out. They do have to have other funding mechanisms in place, and for them, it just wasn't cost effective.
This may seem like a very simple approach, but Mayor Pro Tem mentioned about being proactive. I think as a city we should have an obligation to use Chelsea, but to go out there and find other companies and bring them in and say, hey, you know, we want to do business with you too, along with Chelsea. Competition, market, the good old American way, rather than a monopolized kind of process all the time.
And you know, I disagree with that. I think that they should come to us, they should, whoever is interested should come to us and apply and go through the process. If only Chelsea is interested, then more power to them. I mean, why should we go and chase these people?
I just find that hard to believe, but maybe it's true.
Yeah. Well, out of curiosity, in other cities that you've worked, Terry, is that what they do? Do they go out and look for the customers? Because, I mean, I was talking about this issue after that meeting, and it's just like myself, if as a business owner, I can go out and find federal funds for myself as a female, Hispanic, single parent, cancer survivor, all these different funds that are out there. But me as a business owner, I need to be proactive and look for those funds. No one's going to come and knock on my door or call me and tell me that they're available. Is that kind of like what that works like?
Well, in my past experience, because you asked, and I have worked in every city in Imperial County as either a consultant or a staff member, normally the norm has been that the developer contacts the city for these funds because they have access to that website and they know when the funds are available. This isn't something that just started yesterday. It's been going on for many, many years.
So again, Terry, there are other developers that know about this and they just don't apply?
Yes.
Wow.
Go out there, Mr. Hodge, and twist their arms.
No, it just bothers me. Yeah, but it bothers me. It ranks a monopoly. I don't know. It just bothers me.
Well, it's not a monopoly because the market is open. It's just an issue that somebody like Chelsea can pencil the numbers in. And whatever numbers that the other entities put together, it's not to their satisfaction. It's a decision of a private sector just saying, you know what, I know we can do this, let's put the numbers to it. You know, the profit margin is not agreeable.
I understand, Mr. Mayor, it's good rationale, but my gut feeling just tells me there's something wrong here. I may not have the concrete. I just think that we need at least to let other companies know that this kind of thing exists. Then they can take the steps to come forward, but maybe we're doing that. But. Otherwise, there's no sense in me arguing. I'm not going to change my mind about this. But thank you very much for this.
I would also like to add that if you're in the industry, you know it's available. It's just like myself being in business. I know that there's federal funds out there available. I just don't take the time to do it. And probably a lot of other women out there or business owners or Hispanic business are applying, but I'm just not doing it.
We all make choices. And I think we've belabored this. Mr. Mayor, can we adjourn?
Yes. Anyway,
may
I agree?
Yes. On that issue, administration need to look for options. You're telling me the majority of my colleagues talk about this issue that just because Chelsea, he is very aggressive in these issues, that's the reason. We need to go and decide to work with him. But it's not the way it is. Why? Because what's the reason we have administration? Administration needs to look for options. Options. I mean, if we are going to wait to come with us, I mean, we need to think like a business owner. We need to think like a business owner. Just because somebody up there, they don't know what's going on in Calexico. They don't know about these issues. I mean, so again, we have administration. We pay administration. Administration need to go and look for the benefit of the city of Calexico.
I think we're doing the right thing, Mr. Mayor. I think we should just keep doing the business as we're doing.
Well, that's
not a good track record. I think we should end this meeting.
I'm talking. Let me finish.
Go ahead.
Let me finish.
Finish.
Don't interrupt me, man. So that's the reason I'm concerned about these issues. This is not happens once. It happens a lot of times. That's the reason I not agree on that. We have to go only with one company, like in this case, Chelsea administration. That's about it. Thank you.
Well, one of the things that we can form another subcommittee and ask Mr. Castro and Mr. Hodge to help find somebody. The thing is that Chelsea is like you are in the business sector, Mr. Castro. You do what you have to do to help maintain that business. These people are aware of all these programs that are out there, and they know how to access these programs. If they're deciding that it's not a doable thing, it's not. And as a matter of fact, you asked a question, the city should do more. You heard a moment ago Ms. Nava mention that she has entertained other potential interested parties, and they just did not pencil in the numbers. So I agree. I believe that the city of Calexico, the staff, is doing what it can do. I hope that there's somebody else lands in your lap that can help with this. But until then, I believe you have had success, so continue with it. Anyway, this is an informational item. So if at all, this is the council recognize that we're receipt of this report. Thank you very much.
If I just might give you this one bit of information so that you have that, there have been other developers who have developed in the city of Calexico. We had Calexico 1, Calexico 2. That was not done by Chelsea, I don't believe, right?
Yeah.
So there have been other people. We did the Alejandro Rivera way back when. Some of you will remember that have been here, have a little gray hair. You will remember we did Alejandro Rivera with the CCAC. So there are others. In my 32-year-plus career, I have dealt with three developers besides all those. So it's not like you're going to get, you know, two dozen coming in. There are others out there. They choose not to participate here for whatever reason. There was one that we did at Escalante Plaza, but known in the past as La Pichonera, which we don't refer to it as that anymore. It's Escalante Plaza. Across the street from that, that was a developer I worked with. I personally contacted that developer. He no longer is doing work down here. He's in Colorado. So there are reasons why maybe they're not here. But I just want to make sure everybody understands there are other developers. They just choose at this point not to build here. But there have been others that have built here.
Okay, before we go to the next item, Mr. Gonzalez did ask for a discussion on this item. He is no longer present. Now we'll go to the future agenda items. Mr. Hodge.
One second, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Terry.
One second, please. I don't know all the details about this, but I'd like to put on, I mean, you know, this needs to be worked out by staff. But it was sort of alluded to or brought up at the town hall meeting. Let's consider and maybe gather some information how possible it is, how feasible. But for the city to have a what you want to call a citizens hotline, I mean, we'll continue to go out to the communities, the various areas and neighborhoods, but when they have concerns that they could call in and the respective department heads listen to their concerns, wherever it falls in what department, and then us as a city council have a right to listen to these voicemails or messages so that we're aware of these issues. So I'm proposing for discussion, possible action, a report of some kind of how feasible we could have as a citizens hotline. How effective can it be? But it seemed there was a need from that town hall meeting. Yes, it was only one, but that people appreciate something like that. They'd be able to leave a message. We would, the appropriate person would listen to it. It would be delegated to the right department head, but also city council would have a right to listen, and so that we could do our part in any way. In following up and making the city accountable on as soon as possible basis to our citizens. So I'm proposing a, if you like, if you have a better title, you know, let me know, but a citizen's hotline.
Is that it, Mr. Hodge?
That's it.
Thank you. Mr. Moreno?
Nothing at this time.
Mr. Castro?
Yes, I would like to hear an update on the item number 6 related to the guns for the police department. I would like to hear to move forward on that issue I think for the...
It was approved. It's going.
Yes, we approved that, but I'd like to hear that to make it happen, because there's so many things we approved, and I didn't see to finish it. So that's the reason.
Mr. Casillas probably will make sure that one gets...
Mr. City Manager, by approving it today, what's the timetable to get the...
Exactly, the timetable.
...the police force to get their new guns?
Well, I have talked this over with the chief, and we're making it a priority. I don't know if, I don't know if the lieutenant has, or the chief has timelines as to when this is going out, but I know we've talked that this was a priority.
I'm sorry. It's going out this week, and it should be by the end of next week, we should have it closed. So within 7-8 days, we should have an answer.
So by the end of August, you'll have the new guns available?
Just the other day, and he's saying that on best case scenario, 3 or 4 weeks, and then on a worst case scenario, maybe even up to 60 or 70 days.
So why are you giving us 7 days?
For the bidding process.
Oh, for the bidding process. Yes. Since this is a use of the asset forfeiture funds, we have to go through the bidding process for these guns?
No,
there isn't an exception.
Where we had in the past with this, we had always gone through Glock, the dealership. Unfortunately, since the last time we bought Glocks, now there's three private companies that sell Glocks. And Glock said that as long as they have these retailers, they would rather not be involved in the process. And as a result, it kind of throws us out to these three dealers.
These retailers or these three dealers are closer to the city of Calexico than we used to buy them from?
Well, we used to buy them from Glock Company, and Glock is in Virginia.
Okay.
So we have two in the Bay Area and one in Phoenix.
So the bidding process will be ready before the end of the month, so it would be ready for the next council meeting?
To award? Yes.
And after it gets awarded, then we can cross our fingers that they'll have their guns by the end of September.
That sounds like a cross your fingers, yes.
And that's the quickest way we can get them?
Correct.
Do they have to be this brand?
I'm sorry?
Do they have to be this make and brand of a gun?
Though that is what we have tested. That's what the Calexico Police Department has always used. And it wouldn't make a difference if we went to a different maker model.
It wouldn't make a difference?
No.
You mean it would make a difference?
It actually wouldn't, because all of the Smith & Wesson, Colt, and each of those, they all have a long line of people waiting for their gun to get manufactured.
Oh, okay. So it would be a longer process if we go to a different supplier.
Very possibly.
All right, then. Okay, we got a timeline, crossing our fingers, that we'll have the bid ready at the first meeting in September, and that the weapons will be available for assignment to the officers by the end of September. Is that correct?
That's best my understanding, yes.
Yes, okay. Anything else, Mr. Gus?
That's it.
Thank you. Mayor Pro Tem Murtado?
I have no items.
All right. Going back to the extent of the apology, to Mr. Morales, Mr. Rodriguez, Mr. Servin, I would like for the city attorney or staff to bring forward language on that one ordinance where it removes it as a criteria by the code enforcer and have it reflect that a first violation is a warning and the second one then be considered as a citation. Anyway, we all serve in subcommittees, so one of the things that's our responsibility in these subcommittees is to present ideas and concepts not only to staff, but, well, to staff, so they can move forward. And by the way, my business cards are available. The other thing is that I wish to share is that in the past, as a recent past, Mr. Castro and I have been meeting with Mexicali Mayor on the busing service, being that after some further consideration, there's potential for conflict of interest or appearance of, since either he or his son run the business here in Calexico, I would welcome a second council, another council member, to be part of that committee. Okay?
I would volunteer, Mr. Mayor.
Mayor Pro Tem, it'd be good to have you or Mr. Hodge, since after November, only you two are the ones that are guaranteed to be seated here. So that'd be it. And obviously, we'll be giving the full council an update on what's going on with these meetings.
Okay, so you appoint who? Who do you appoint?
Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado will now resume your place in that capacity. Mm-hmm. And of course, any discussions with directly with CBP regarding the permitting process, that will still run directly through you and your son.
To my son.
Uh-huh.
You already mentioned it's a conflict, right?
Well, if you, by you continuing some discussions on the planning area, mm-hmm. That could be interpreted as a conflict of interest because it's your son's business and you're directly involved as a council member.
Let me ask you this. Well, no, that's okay.
Anyway, you'll be given direction.
Okay.
All right. If there's nothing else, meeting's adjourned at 9:23.
Yeah. I said about 9:30.